Recorded Books and RB Digital present Irving Berlin, New York Genius, by James Kaplan. Narrated by L.J. Ganser. Chapter 1. The Fugitive. A photograph survives of Irving Berlin at 13, a solemn, chubby-cheeked boy in a dark suit and tie, in all likelihood his bar mitzvah suit. On what other occasion in the year 1901 would an immigrant Jewish boy be thus photographed? Young Israel Balin, for this was still his name, sits carefully posed, hands folded, looking not at the camera but, in the style of the time, thoughtfully off to the side. His eyes and thick brows are dark, his gaze intense. This boy seems to be watching something carefully, or appears, at the very least, intensely aware. His keen attention to whatever it is notwithstanding, his thin lips form a surprisingly relaxed expression, an almost smile. It is a remarkable face, though one impossible to take in without the knowledge of who and what the chubby-faced boy will become. And if indeed this is a bar mitzvah photograph, it marks a notable juncture in Israel Balin's life, well beyond the symbolic, for his childhood will soon actually, and quite abruptly, come to an end. He was the baby of the family, the eighth and youngest child of Leah and Moses Balin, recent immigrants from Eastern Europe. Moses was an itinerant cantor who, for whatever reason, would have terrible trouble finding work in New York. Before the Balins left the old country, they seemed to have lived for a while in the city of Tumen, in western Siberia, where Israel is said to have been born on May 11, 1888. At some point, the family moved to Tolachin, Belarusia. As is the case with so many Eastern European Jews of that era, accounts are sketchy. This much, however, is known. Late in the summer of 1893, Moses and Leah's family left Europe for good, part of the great Jewish exodus that had begun a decade earlier amid the vicious, institutionalized anti-Semitism and widespread pogroms that characterized the reign of Tsar Alexander III. In later life, Irving Berlin claimed that his earliest memory, at age 3 or 4, was of lying on a blanket by the side of a road, watching his family's house burn down, a terrifying image of loss. After a long and arduous trip by foot and rail across Europe, and then, even more gruelingly, in steerage over the Atlantic, the Balins arrived at New York Harbor on September 14, 1893, on the Red Star Line's SS Rheinland out of Antwerp. The family spoke only Yiddish, and the surname as spelled on the ship's manifest is surely an Anglicization of what would previously have been written in Hebrew or Cyrillic characters. In any case, during processing at Ellis Island, an immigration clerk, probably from hearing Moses pronounce the name, changed the spelling once more, and Balin, pronounced, depending on whom you ask, either Balin, Aspandi, or Balin, it stayed for the time being. And then the family settled, like so many thousands of their ilk, like my father's father's family, for example, and perhaps like some of your ancestors, too, in a Lower East Side tenement. At first, in the Balin's case, home was a basement apartment on Monroe Street. 8 people, fresh off the boat and disoriented, in a windowless 3-room cellar with no running water, the privy in the courtyard. One wonders what dreams, if any, of the Golden Medina, the Golden Land, survived this shock. The family had arrived in the teeth of a national financial crisis, the Panic of 1893. Banks, railroads, and farms were failing. Factory and mill jobs vanished. Yet somehow the lower orders survived. A few years on, the Balin's situation had even improved slightly. The 1900 U.S. Census shows the family, now numbering only 7, 20-year-old Sophie had married and left the nest, occupying the second floor of a tenement at 354 Cherry Street. Amid the teeming chaos of the Lower East Side, the Balins, like 100,000 other immigrant families, somehow managed to put together a living, in their case without much help from the nominal head of the household. In 1893, the ship's manifest of the Rheinland had listed the 44-year-old Moses Balin's occupation as butcher, perhaps since he had worked as a schomer, an inspector of kosher chickens. 6.5 years on, the 1900 census lists his profession as painter, also noting that he has been out of work for 9 months. Cantor or painter or chicken inspector, unemployed was unemployed. As for Moses' wife, her name Americanized to Lena on the census form, no profession, trade, or occupation is listed. She is said to have contributed to the family income by assisting in the delivery of babies. 22-year-old Sarah Balin is listed as a wrapper maker for cigars, employed, as is 15-year-old Augusta. On the other hand, the other two older children, 19-year-old Benjamin, a shirt maker, and 17-year-old Rebecca, also a wrapper maker, are declared out of work. 13-year-old Israel's occupation is listed simply as school. Of the theoretical breadwinner, next to nothing is known. Berlin, who adored his mother, he kept a photograph of her by his bedside long after her death in 1922, scarcely spoke of Moses, even to his own daughters. Perhaps he was ashamed. After a half dozen years scrounging for work in the New World, Moses Balin, whether through hard luck, illness, depression, or some combination thereof, had hit a dead end. On the other hand, he was apparently able to find a post, paid or not, during the High Holy Days, leading the choir in a Lower East Side temple. Oh, and he took along his youngest son, who could also sing a little. At what age Irving Berlin began to vocalize in public is anybody's guess. Accounts of his early years, especially his own, are hazy at best. But it seems plausible that he first became a sidewalk entertainer of sorts not long after he started working as a newsboy, at about age 8, hawking William Randolph Hearst's sensationalistic New York Journal on the hard streets of the Bowery. It was a business whose minuscule profit margins, half a cent per paper sold, rewarded only the most energetic and assertive. But then from childhood, Izzy Balin seems to have been what is called in Yiddish a Brenn, from the German word brennen, to burn. Someone of great energy, vivacity, competence, and optimism, according to Leo Rosten, a fireball. Good-looking in a small and dark way, quick on his feet and quick-witted. His first ambition was to be a cartoonist, a profession that had just become big business. In 1896, around the time the 8-year-old Izzy hit the streets as a newsboy, Hearst's journal stole the nation's premier cartoonist, Richard F. Outcault, from Joseph Pulitzer's New York World. Outcault had created a national sensation with his comic Hogan's Alley, set in a fictional slum populated by children of various ethnicities, chief among them a shaved-headed boy known, for the color of the smock he wore, as the Yellow Kid. Young Izzy, with a bundle of journals in his bag, would certainly have had plenty of opportunity to look over Outcult's work, which often appeared on the front page, and no doubt he gazed with admiring recognition at the antics of the kid and his pals, marveling at Outcult's ability to render the chaotic essence of tenement life with a few strokes of his pen. This was storytelling at its most economical, thoroughly American in style and substance, and the storyteller was, no doubt, a very rich man. Izzy had seen boys and men make money by drawing caricatures in chalk on the sidewalk. He decided to give it a try himself. He had a lot of funny ideas, but discovered he wasn't much of a draftsman. What he could do was sing. A half-cent profit per paper wasn't much, but Izzy found that if he broke into song, the paper buyers might toss an extra penny or two his way. He could keep a tune. The boy had a clear, true soprano voice, a plaintive voice tuned to the grieving of the Schule. Berlin's first biographer, Alexander Woolcott, wrote. To which one is tempted to say, oi. But then Woolcott, who was taking his close friend's measure in 1925, when Berlin was all of 37, was in an era of unapologetic waspocracy. A wasp mandarin, the New York Times' chief drama critic, a columnist for The New Yorker, and a charter member of the Algonquin Round Table, where Berlin occasionally sat in, who wrote with affection and florid verve, not to mention a certain ham-handedness common to the age, when it came to matters Judaic. At any rate, young Israel Balin, as a recent greenhorn, eager to oiskren in zik, literally de-green himself, would have been eager to get out of shul and onto the street. The end of the 19th century was a time of rich cultural ferment in America. The young nation was casting off European influences and forging a brash, demotic personality of its own in politics, literature, even popular music. And for music, New York City was the hot center of the action. Vaudeville had begun here in 1881 at Tony Pastor's Theater on 14th Street near 3rd Avenue, when that impresario realized he could instantly double his audience for variety shows by cleaning up the material and banning the sale of alcohol on the premises, thereby bringing in women as well as men. Shows needed songs, and by the middle 80s, music publishers began to cluster in the Manhattan neighborhood just north of Madison Square that would soon come to be known as Tin Pan Alley. With the explosive growth of piano manufacturing in the late 19th century, suddenly every middle-class home had to have an upright, came huge growth in the market for sheet music. In 1892, Charles K. Harris's ballad, After the Ball, became the first popular song to sell a million copies. In those pre-radio days, music was to be heard everywhere on the streets of the city, from street musicians or buskers who played the hurdy-gurdy, street piano, or spoons, or just stood there and sang, from the upright pianos found in every saloon and aspiring middle-class parlor. Izzy Balin would have taken it all in, would have heard After the Ball, and Little Annie Rooney, and The Sidewalks of New York, and A Bird in a Gilded Cage, and The Band Played On, and dozens of other tunes of the late 90s and early aughts, drippingly sentimental, most of them, as was the style of the day, and many of them in waltz time, a carryover from Europe. The schmaltziness of these songs made them highly susceptible to parody, if one were of a satirical turn of mind, and Izzy Balin, who was, may have begun creating racy special lyrics as early as his newsboy days. Then his life imploded. In his accounts of his boyhood, Irving Berlin tended to polish up the same select bunch of chestnuts again and again. The getting knocked off the dock by the crane story. He was fished out of the water, still clutching the 5 pennies he'd made selling papers that day. The yarn of how he pawned, bit by brass bit, the samovar his family had brought over from the old country. The tale of how he learned about Christmas by going across the street to his poor Irish neighbors, the O'Haras, whose stumpy and scraggly Christmas tree, the ancestor of Charlie Brown's, nevertheless seemed to young Izzy to tower to heaven. What he never discussed, with his 3 daughters, or with his French son-in-law, Edouard Emmett, with whom Berlin liked to reminisce as the two men strolled the sidewalks of Paris together in the 1960s, was the death of his father, when Izzy was 13. In later years, Irving Berlin spoke only obliquely, and with insistent nostalgia about his early days. Everyone should have a Lower East Side in their lives, he said. Close to 60, he told the New York Sun. I never felt poverty because I'd never known anything else. We had an enormous family, 8 or 9 in 4 rooms, and in the summer some of us slept on the fire escape or on the roof. I was a boy with poor parents, but let's be realistic about it. I didn't starve, I wasn't cold or hungry. There was always bread and butter and hot tea. I slept better in tenement houses than I do now in a nice bed. Speaking to his son-in-law, Berlin slightly fleshed out the story. He said that in the summertime the tenement became unbearable, Emmett recalled. They were crowded. There was him and his brother, surrounded by his sisters and mother. His father quickly was no longer there. The only record we have of Moses Balin's passing is a stark one. His New York City death certificate, dated July 19, 1901. The cause of death is listed as chronic bronchitis and arteriosclerosis. He was 53. And his youngest child was 13. In all likelihood, Izzy made the decision that September, when he would have been about to enter the 7th or 8th grade at PS 147 on East Broadway. A quick study, he had taken in all he felt he needed to know, grammar and penmanship and arithmetic, the fundamentals of civics. School, especially with just a few dollars a week coming into the household, was now quite superfluous. But the household itself? Woolcott describes young Izzy's leave-taking from 354 Cherry Street. As far as he knew, there was always enough to eat, stewing away on the back of Mother Baleen's stove. But he knew, too, that he contributed less than the least of his sisters and that skeptical eyes were being turned on him as his legs lengthened and his earning power remained the same. Finally, in a miserable retreat from reproaches unspoken, he cleared out one evening after supper, vaguely bent on fending for himself or starving if he failed. In the idiom of his neighborhood, where the phenomenon was not uncommon, he went on the bum. Berlin told a rather different tale to his family, recalling, according to the eldest of his three daughters, Mary Ellen Barrett, his uncomfortableness with a household of nothing but women. Ben had moved out, and a certain desire to get away from all the women. Izzy already knew the Bowery well. He had acquired a street education there, selling his papers along raucous sidewalks deeply shadowed by the elevated tracks. The district was, Berlin biographer Edward Jablonski writes, the place to go for entertainment, inebriation, drugs, prostitutes, and colorful characters. In addition, it was the locus of fleecing, robbery, venereal diseases, and even murder. Now and then, the newsboy would step into one of the saloons, where minors were of course expressly prohibited, to try moving a few journals. Here he found a different kind of clamor than on the street, the pounding of an out-of-tune upright, drunken singing and bragging and joking and ragging, and once, perhaps amid the din, a high voice piping. She's only a bird in a gilded cage, a beautiful sight to see. You may think she's happy and free from care. She's not, though she seems to be. Izzy would have watched the drunken men as the urchins sang, some ignoring him, some laughing scornfully, but not a few discreetly wiping away a tear at the memory, or the dream, of such innocence. Then a coin was thrown at the boy's feet, and then another, and another. Indian head pennies mostly, but here and there a buffalo nickel or liberty dime. The kids scuttled to grab the loose change. An instant later, the bouncer was grabbing the kid by the arm and slinging him out the door. But he had his dinner money. And Izzy, looking on with fascination, had a plan. Chapter 2. I Have Discovered a Great Kid. He could sing. He could keep a tune. He could remember the words. He could, if the spirit or the audience moved him, fill in better, spicier words of his own. It may not be overreaching to say that even then, barely into his teens, he felt a fascination for what a song said and how it said it, how it was put together, where the rhymes fell, whether it was silly or moving, trivial or well-made. And so, Izzy Baleen joined the great corps of buskers on the streets of the Lower East Side, the sidewalks of New York, as the song so romantically put it. The real sidewalks of New York were, as we have seen, a little less than romantic, beginning with the ubiquitous horse shit, and sometimes horse carrion, that the lyrics failed to mention. Not to mention, if you happen to be a Jew, the Italian and Irish kids who would just as soon smash your head in as look at you. But Izzy was nimble, quick on his feet and quick with words, too, both in tight spots and in the saloons, where sometimes, as he raised his high voice in song, it grew huskier, but not much deeper, as he matured. The words came out not precisely as the songwriter had written. She's only a bird in a gilded cage, a beautiful sight to see. Her hourglass figure is all the rage. Her charms can be yours for a fee. Or something along those lines. He would have noted with his sharp eye that these men in their cups were suckers for sentimentality. But his quicksilver wit proved equally appealing, if not more so. A slightly, or more than slightly, ribald twist to the lyrics could surprise and delight, almost as though he had performed an act of prestidigitation. Working Bowery saloons like the morgue, the bucket of blood, the flea bag, and suicide hall, places named with swaggering, slightly self-conscious irony, for the Bowery was a magnet not just to drunks and the lower classes seeking amusement, but to uptown slummers. Izzy learned to be deft in all ways, even with his feet. He could stamp on a coin, slide it toward his hand, and pocket it in a flash, all without breaking the phrase of the song. If Leah had known where her youngest child was laying his head at night, she would never have slept at all. There was, for example, the Cobdock Hotel, to which the gals would take their sailors, as Berlin jauntily recalled years later, and the Mascot, a 15-cents-a-night joint, where he lived for a year of his adolescence. You got a cubbyhole to sleep in, open at the top, and you were always scared that somebody would reach over and steal your pants. Or worse, Berlin's recollections mostly tap-danced over the problems of bedbugs, disease, and the sheer dangers inherent in close and disreputable quarters. In one flophouse, Izzy got into a fight with another boy that nearly turned deadly. The kid stabbed me, and I was rushed to Bellevue, Berlin remembered. What he didn't say was that the kid with the knife no doubt carried it for defensive purposes. God alone knew, in a world of boys and men on the bum together, who might be reaching over from the next cubbyhole, and not just for your pants. Still, one way and another, he survived. For a while, he worked as a seeing eye boy to a busker named Blind Saul, who fiddled in saloons while his watchful young assistant sang along and monitored the take. Then Izzy took a fateful step up. Just before his 14th birthday, in early 1902, he auditioned for and won a spot in the chorus of a musical called The Showgirl, with songs by H.L. Hertz and R.A. Barnett. The show left Manhattan that spring for out-of-town tryouts, and chorus boy Baleen must have had something on the ball, for he was assigned the bit of rushing out front during a lull in the action, climbing to one of the stage side boxes, and breaking into a Hertz and Barnett number called Sammy. Even at the turn of the century, this bit, called The Singing Stooge, had been around a while. The surprise of hearing what seemed to be an audience member suddenly pipe up could galvanize a house and sell a song. But somehow either Sammy or Izzy failed to sell, and the chorus boy was given his walking papers in Binghamton, New York. Nevertheless, the bug had bitten him, and Izzy Baleen had faith in himself. In the crucible of the Bowery, under the toughest of conditions, he had learned how to put over a song, whether sentimental or ribald, and make a tough crowd eat out of his hand. A nervy kid, he knew he could do it again. So he marched uptown to Tin Pan Alley, the block of 28th Street between 5th and 6th Avenues that got its name from the din of dozens of music publishers' pianos banging and clanging through open transoms and windows, and presented his credentials to none less than Harry Von Tilzer. The already legendary songwriter with the mysterious, vaguely noble-sounding name had been born Aaron Gumbinski in 1872 in Goshen, Indiana, the son of Polish-Jewish immigrants. At 14, he ran away with the circus and soon began writing songs. Once started, he seemed barely able to stop. Von Tilzer claimed to have written 8,000 tunes in his life, at least a dozen, numbers such as A Bird in a Gilded Cage, Wait Till the Sun Shines, Nelly, I Want a Girl, Just Like the Girl That Married Dear Old Dad, became million sellers when sales, tallied by copies of sheet music sold, were driven by nothing more than word of mouth or the sound of a song being played on a neighbor's parlor piano or in a music store. Von Tilzer also made a substantial part of his living writing in a genre that flourished during the age of immigration, the ethnic number. He turned out Irish and German dialect tunes by the score, as well as dozens in black dialect, the variant then known with unapologetic offensiveness as coon songs. One of them, 1904's Alexander, Don't You Love Your Baby No More, got its comic lift from the contemporary convention that Alexander was a ridiculously pretentious name for a black man. Mere compositional volume wasn't enough, however. Von Tilzer had figured out early on that while it was all well and good to make a nickel a copy on a song he'd written, and that he could do very well indeed with a million seller, in the days when the average American income was something like $600 a year, it was even better to publish the music himself, assuming the downside risk, but, knowing he had a cascade of hits in him, planning for a significant upside. After serving 2 years as the junior partner to the publishers Shapiro and Bernstein, in 1902 he opened the Harry Von Tilzer Music Publishing Company at 37 West 28th Street. And in walks this boy, Izzy Balin, who has somehow managed to talk his way into an audience with the man himself. Von Tilzer, not yet 30 but prematurely balding, with a long, sensitive face, took one look at this 14-year-old street kid, small, dark-eyed, full of beans, and felt some kind of pull. No doubt Izzy told him about Sammy, and no doubt Von Tilzer asked him to sing a few bars. A cappella. Izzy, being the crackerjack he was, would have had the wit to throw in some of Von Tilzer's own stuff as well. As he sang, Izzy certainly would have glanced around the prosperous young songwriter publisher's swell new office and taken it all in. The great Harry Von Tilzer hired Israel Balin on the spot to be a song plugger at the grand salary of $5 a week. Young Balin's job as a boomer was to use that sweet, hoarse voice of his to demonstrate Von Tilzer compositions to possible song buyers, in the public and in show business alike. And Von Tilzer had just the song for him. It was another of his specialties, a fallen woman tearjerker, very much in the mold of Bird in a Gilded Cage, even the meter was identical, called The Mansion of Aching Hearts. Once again, the lyricist was the Englishman Arthur J. Lamb. She lives in a mansion of aching hearts. She's one of a restless throng. The diamonds that glitter around her throat, they speak both of sorrow and song. Few listeners, even in those supposedly more innocent times, would have failed to understand exactly what kind of house the mansion in question was. And, canny businessman that he was, Von Tilzer would have known how strangely moving the song would be when crooned by an adolescent boy. The coarsest possible subject matter in the sweetest possible package. And the songwriter publisher had just the family-friendly venue in mind for the song's introduction. 20 years on, Tony Pastor's Music Hall, the cradle of vaudeville, was still going strong on East 14th Street. And one of Pastor's most popular attractions in 1902 was a family act that featured an actual family. As a review of the era put it, "For real rough and tumble fun, there is no act which equals that of the three Keatons, father, mother, and son. The latter, the inimitable Buster, is one of the funniest little fellows on the stage." The rough and tumble fun went as follows. Ma Keaton would stand to the side of the stage and play saxophone, while Pa Keaton threw Buster around. Literally, the child, aged 7 that autumn, had a handle sewn onto the back of his shirt so that his father could get a good grip. Little Buster, who'd learned early on how to break his fall with a covertly extended arm or leg, would fly across the stage, land in a heap, then stand up, dust himself off, and make droll, stone-faced remarks, much to the audience's amusement. Then, at a crucial juncture in the merriment, the stage orchestra would segue into Von Tilzer's latest song, and young Izzy Balin would rise from his balcony seat and burst into a stirring tenor rendition of The Mansion of Aching Hearts. This he did for 2 shows a day, until the Keatons headed off to the next stop on the Keith Albee circuit. The chronology of Israel Balin's years on the bum, especially the period from his 14th to 16th years, is short on detail but long on pluck. After Pastor's Izzy returned to busking, he also worked as a slide singer at the primitive movie theaters known as Nickelodeons, leading audience sing-alongs during the piano interludes that accompanied reel changes as the lyrics, on slides, flashed onto the screen. Most remarkably, during the formative years of his adolescence, without a parental hand to guide him, Izzy seems to have avoided the seamy pitfalls with which his stomping grounds were richly furnished. And he didn't just survive. He appears somehow to have thrived, finding occupation, amusement, friends. Even father figures, of a sort. One was a tough-talking, derby-wearing mountebank named George Washington Connors, better known as Chuck. The former prizefighter, who dubbed himself the mayor of Chinatown, made his living showing wide-eyed uptowners the colorful lowlife among that district's dark, crooked streets, opium dens, cockfighting pits, bordellos, all the while providing a running narrative in a singular Bowery Boy Cockney patois. And at some point, no one knows where or how, Chuck Connors took a shine to the gutsy young Jewish busker and told him he could do better than singing on the street. Accordingly, one day in early 1904, Connors led Izzy Berlin through the swinging doors of the Pelham Cafe in the heart of Chinatown at 12 Pell Street, better known as, there is no other way to say it than to say it, Nigger Mike's. The Pelham, crudely nicknamed after its owner Mike Salter, a Russian Jew with olive skin, kinky hair, and a broad nose, was the liveliest stop on Chuck Connors' Slummers tour, a saloon and dance hall featuring singing waiters, a backroom piano player, and a whorehouse upstairs. Salter took one look at the runty 15-year-old with the unruly mop of hair and said he didn't need any more waiting help. But the irrepressible Izzy was hard of hearing when it came to the word no. After the owner stepped out, Berlin biographer Philip Furia writes, "He began singing to the customers. When the other waiters tried to drown him out, he sang louder and finally won the crowd over just as Salter returned. And so, for the impressive sum of $7 a week, plus tips, Izzy landed his first steady job. One of his first tasks was running around the corner to Olive's Apothecary at 6 Bowery, owned and operated by the brothers Joseph and Nicholas Schenck, to pick up supplies of the purgative with which Mike dosed the drinks of undesirable customers. Of which there were plenty. Both the Pelham and its rival around the corner, Callahan's Dance Saloon, sat in dangerous territory. The bend of Doyers Street, also known as the Bloody Angle, was the epicenter of the Chinese Tong Wars, and Pell Doyers was a kind of no-man's land between the turfs of the rival, Irish-Italian Five Points, and Jewish Eastman gangs. Irving Berlin told a reporter many years later, "I got my musical education in the Bowery, but I never mingled with the real tough people, so-called guerrillas, but attended strictly to business." Business itself was tough enough. The clientele was drunk and rowdy, and the hours were 8 to 6, 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. This flip-flopped circadian rhythm stayed with Izzy for the next 85 years of his life, contributing to his lifelong insomnia. The patrons dispensed their tips by tossing coins onto the floor, partly, one guesses, for the sadistic pleasure of watching the waiters scurry for them. Nickel kickers, the waiters were called, and the biggest tips would come, Izzy Berlin found, when he deployed his subspecialty, improvising dirty lyrics to the schmaltzy hits of the day, especially yet another Von Tilzer composition, "Are You Coming Out Tonight, Mary Ann?" Imagine the possibilities. The quick-witted Izzy could, and did, to the raucous delight of the patrons. One impressed customer was a 21-year-old Harry Von Tilzer song plugger and talent scout named Max Winslow. After hearing the young waiter's blue parody of Mary Ann, Winslow came back to the Pelham again and again. At last, as Von Tilzer recalled in an unpublished autobiography, the talent scout could contain himself no longer. "Max Winslow came to me and said, 'I have discovered a great kid I would like to see you write some songs with.' Max raved about him so much. But for all Winslow's enthusiasm, and with plenty of songwriting talent already in-house, von Tilzer took a pass on Izzy Berlin. The following year, there was a stir in the neighborhood when the house pianist at Callahan's, Al Piantedosi, wrote a song that, wonder of wonders, actually got published. Its name was My Mariuccia Take a Steamboat, and its Italian dialect lyric, written by Callahan's bouncer Big Jerry, sounded like Chico Marx avant la lettre. My Mariuccia take a steamboat, woo-woo. She's a-gone away. She make too much jealous for me. She fly away. In the undemanding world of 1906 ethnic songs, My Mariuccia caught on and enjoyed a brief vogue, quite gallingly to Mike Salter, for the tune siphoned away customers from the Pelham to Callahan's, where they were eager to hear Al and Big Jerry themselves perform it, while the drunk and delighted crowd chimed in on the steamboat whistle, woo-woos. And so one day, Salter turned to his house pianist, Michael Nick Nicholson, and his wiseacre singing waiter Izzy, and said, "You're so goddamn smart. Why don't you write something like that?" Or words to that effect. It was one thing, Izzy Berlin quickly found, to improvise dirty lyrics to a song someone else had written. It was quite another to invent brand new words for a brand new melody. As Irving Berlin told the Broadway columnist Ed Sullivan in the late 1930s, "I never wanted to be a songwriter. All I wanted in those days was a job in which I could earn $25 a week. That was my idea of heaven." Yet Izzy and Nick sat at the piano and, note by note, sweated out the song that became Marie from Sunny Italy. All these years later, you can still smell the sweat. Irving Berlin himself was recorded singing the tune during a CBS radio tribute on his 50th birthday in 1938. It's a winsome rendition. In Berlin's light, hoarse tenor, the sheer charm of it almost covers the song's sheer lousiness. "My sweet Marie from sunny Italy, oh, how I do love you. Say that you'll love me too. Forevermore I will be true." No doubt someone, Berlin or Nicholson, committed this deathless poetry to paper. But then, conceivably after a forehead-smacking double take, it occurred to the musically illiterate songwriters that they were going to have to find somebody to actually put the notes of the song down on paper. The job was finally done by one Julius Saranoff, a fiddler and occasional entertainer at the Pelham. The next step was to get the thing published. The tunesmiths wound up at the firm of Joseph W. Stern and Company, which, as Edward Jablonski notes, was actually not in Tin Pan Alley proper, but 10 blocks north, at 102-104 West 38th Street. Song publishing in the early 1900s was a land rush business. By 1910, Tin Pan Alley was spewing out some 25,000 titles a year, and with sheet music cheap to produce and sales of more than 5 million units per annum, publishers could afford to take a chance on more than a few dogs. In this undemanding context, Joseph W. Stern and Company sent Julius Saranoff's lead sheet, the first handwritten rendition on staff paper of a song's music and lyrics, to a cover designer. An edition was printed, and soon Izzy Berlin, no doubt very proud and probably also a little incredulous, was holding the sheet music for Marie from Sunny Italy in his hands. Cover designs in those palmy days of sheet music were an art in themselves, and Marie's cover was a nice enough-looking example of the genre. A greenish, one-tone illustration depicting a mandolin-playing swain serenading his lady love on a gondola crossing a Venetian lagoon. As was the common practice then, the cover also featured an inset photograph of a singer. In this case, for some reason, the pretty Yiddish theater performer, Leah Russell. All nice enough, and conventional enough. But what jumps out to the modern eye are the names of the songwriters, lettered in dark green over the lagoon's gray-green waters, just beneath the gondola's prow. Words by I. Berlin, music by M. Nicholson. According to Woolcott, who would have had it straight from Irving, people had started to call him Berlin sometime after he first arrived on the Bowery. For some reason, his really distinguished patronymic, Berlin, proved difficult to his neighbors, and Berlin represents an effort to spell out the sound of the thing everyone called him anyway. Berlin, Berlin. A plausible theory, but in all likelihood, only part of the truth. No doubt, Izzy Berlin still wished to oiskrinen sich, to look American, sound American, be American, as quickly as possible. Berlin may have been the name of a foreign capital, but at least it was familiar. A word everybody knew, one that ended in a consonant rather than a vowel. Philip Furia maintains the name was a shrewd choice, one that drew upon the reverence of Americans toward German composers. Maybe. Most likely Berlin just looked good, and sounded good to Berlin. But then there was that pesky first name. Woolcott says that young Izzy had, for some time, harbored a secret ambition to be known as Irving. He wasn't alone. Such, then, British-sounding and therefore classy-sounding given names as Irving, Murray, Milton, Seymour, and Sidney became wildly popular among Jews in the early 1900s, who little suspected how typically Jewish these names would come to sound in time. Yet, Woolcott tells us, Berlin was shy at first about a complete transformation. When the time came to publish the first song, he itched to sign it Irving Berlin, but he knew a copy would always be left casually on the piano rack at Nigger Mike's, and he feared the derision of the gang. Still, Israel was too solemn and Talmudic a name with which to depress a popular song. Izzy was too ornery. It smacked of Cherry Street and sweltering doorsteps. So, compromising between an old pride and a new embarrassment, he signed the first song, I, Berlin. He was still in the pupil stage of his metamorphosis. Marie from sunny Italy may have made him a songwriter on paper, but not many people, including in all likelihood the lyricist himself, considered it much of a song. At least my Mariuccia, for all its caricatured Italianness, had the virtue, those steamboat whistles, of being fun. And fun went a long way in selling a song in those days, as did Schmaltz. Marie, earnest in the extreme, wasn't really either. Published on May 8, 1907, it earned its composers precisely 75 cents in royalties that year, and $1.20 the next, meaning that if Joseph W. Stern and Company had published 10,000 copies of the sheet music, a common print run, and sold them at 10 cents each, the company had moved about 2,000 units. Taken a bath, in other words. Irving Berlin claimed in later years that his pharmacist pal, Joe Schenck, had bought the first copy, which, if true, showed early on what a good and loyal friend Joe Schenck was destined to be. Chapter 3. You can never tell your finish when you start. Officially, I, Berlin, was a songwriter. But at this point, he would have been hard-pressed to prove to anyone, himself included, that he was anything but a 19-year-old singing waiter. And in very short order, after the publication of Marie from Sunny Italy, he was an unemployed one. The details of Izzy's firing from the Pelham Cafe are murky. One night in early 1907, apparently, Mike Salter left him in charge of the cash register. And after Izzy fell asleep at his post, $25, the equivalent of some $600 today, vanished from the till. No small matter. Yet, some say Salter took the money himself, either drunkenly, forgetting about it afterward, or maliciously, to punish Izzy for his dereliction. Whatever the case, Nigger Mike, disappointed with his junior waiter, unceremoniously kicked him to the curb he'd come from. But the enterprising and affable Berlin quickly found another job, with higher pay and better hours, uptown at a new saloon called Jimmy Kelly's Folly on East 14th Street, just a stone's throw from Tony Pastor's music hall, not to mention much closer to Tin Pan Alley. Uptown meant a better class of barroom clientele, specifically and significantly, the show business types, jugglers, comedians, tenors, and hoofers, in Woolcott's words, who appeared at Pastor's and other nearby houses, in what was then a vibrant theatrical district. The show people were drawn to the whip-smart, entertaining young waiter, and he to them. Max Winslow, the Von Tilzer talent scout, who had been so impressed by Izzy at the Pelham, found him again at Kelly's. By and by, the two young men became friends. Friendship was something that Berlin, from the beginning, never took lightly. Throughout his long life, he would have hundreds of acquaintances and correspondents, and perhaps a half dozen intimates. Though outwardly amiable, Berlin didn't let people in easily. He possessed a core of intense feeling, shadowed by early loss and deprivation. And as a genius in progress, he would, from the beginning, have been an observer above all. Winslow and Izzy found a furnished room on East 18th Street, just off Union Square, and became roommates. Flophouses were a thing of the past. With a little more money coming in, the young waiter could get his unruly hair barbered regularly and begin to pay attention to his wardrobe. He could also start to think about his future rather than mere survival. On his free afternoons, he walked the cacophonous sidewalks of Tin Pan Alley, soaking in the atmosphere, listening to words and music. One day, at one of the music publishers, it was probably the fall of 1907, he encountered a live wire of a girl, a 16-year-old with a substantial nose, direct brown eyes, and a sly sense of humor. Within the first minute, Izzy knew two things about Fanny Borach, as she was then known. She was convinced she was going to make it in show business, and for the time being, she was working, just as he had a few years earlier, as a slide singer in a Nickelodeon. She was there looking for songs, as, in a way, he was too. The two hit it off immediately. Years later, Borach, who had long since become Fanny Bryce, remembered a brown-eyed, mild young man who generally came forward offering diffident suggestions about what she might sing. Shy or not, though, he became convulsed with laughter when they piped up together on one of the publisher's more corn-syrupy offerings, something about a moon, a girl, a boat, a float. He thought he could do better. But actually, doing it was something else. Back to Kelly's he went, and with racking labors and the help of the house pianist, Izzy sat down and wrote a song of his own, words and music, something called The Best of Friends Must Part. What's that you say? No work today? Done lost your job? Where is your pay? It was a character song, ethnic around the edges, and though far from memorable, it was a big step up from Marie from sunny Italy, with its little birds and plinking mandolin. The Best of Friends may have lacked grace and lyricism, and humor, Berlin's hallmark, once he really became Berlin, but it had an appealingly unconventional social realist grit. The only significance this song has, Berlin wrote almost 75 years later, is that it was published on February 6, 1908, in Tin Pan Alley on 28th Street by the Selig Publishing Company. I think Selig later became a silent movie producer. But he was being too hard on himself. The quality of the song aside, what it signified, both in content and execution, was the determination of a young man who had pulled himself up from nothing and meant, by hook or by crook, to go far higher. He tried just one more song in 1908, and only a few weeks after The Best of Friends, an ethnic number, a coon song, to put a fine point on it, called Queenie. This time, Berlin wrote just the lyrics. The music was by one Maurice Abrahams, which this time were barely serviceable, and so of their genre that there is no redeeming them. The moon above am shining, love, etc. The Thing was published at the end of February, and he wrote nothing further that year. Perhaps as he turned 20, Izzy was rethinking his ambitions. But then, quite by chance, an itinerant song and dance man, his name lost to history, stopped by Jimmy Kelly's one night and inadvertently put I, Berlin, on the path to becoming Irving Berlin. In these more orotund days, the dramatic recitation was a vaudeville commonplace. A rich-voiced ham could transfix an audience, move it to tears or laughter by intoning Gunga Din or Casey at the Bat, or something in a funny Italian or Irish or African-American accent. And one night in early 1909, the song and dance man in question booked to appear at Tony Pastor's and, anxious for fresh material, went to the Folly for some liquid inspiration, heard Izzy the waiter perform one of his dirty parodies, and had an idea. The vaudevillian pulled the waiter aside. There was $10 in it for him if he could come up with a wop or a mick or a coon piece for the player to recite. $10 was a lot of money. So, late one night, Izzy sat down with fountain pen and paper and scratched out Durando. Durando Pietri was an Italian runner who had been disqualified from the 1908 Olympic marathon after collapsing in the final stretch and being helped across the finish line. The incident drew the world's sympathy, and afterwards, Durando became a celebrity athlete, competing in several professional races in America, including one he lost to an Indian named Thomas Longboat. Berlin's witty conceit, and this was the first time his native wit made an appearance in a formal lyric, was to imagine an Italian barber who sold his barbershop to finance a big bet on his compatriot and idol, and lost everything on the longboat race. The fledgling writer laid out his tale in marinara thick dialect. Durando, Durando, he ran, ran, ran like anything. 1, 2, 100 times around the ring. I cry, please, Anunga, never stop. Just then, Durando, he's a drop. Three energetic stanzas tell the whole story. Barber sells shop to bet on Durando. Durando collapses. Durando explains his failure afterward. And the explanation makes a wacky kind of sense. It turns out that whoever fed the runner before the race gave him Irish beef a stool instead of his favorite carbo load, spaghetti. I know it make me run a quick. Set aside your genteel modern distaste for ethnic humor, and what you find is an economic and effective piece of storytelling, charmingly based on current events, written by a sixth-grade dropout who served beer for a living. And the song and dance man stiffed him on the $10. Ever resilient, Berlin took his lyric uptown to Ted Snyder, a music publisher on 38th Street, just west of the 6th Avenue L. Snyder's office manager and gate guardian, Henry Watterson, a big, bushy-browed, smiley-tough character, told Berlin he would listen to his recitation if he made it fast. Izzy went into high busking mode and gave him Durando. Well, said Watterson, according to Woolcott, I suppose you've got a tune to this? Yes, lied the singing waiter from Jimmy Kelly's, thinking, if at all, that he would dig up a pianist and get a tune from him before noon next day. All right, said Watterson. I'll give you $25 for the thing. Words and music. Just you trot into the next room to the arranger and he'll take your tune down for you. In which moment of agony, Berlin could only clutch at his manuscript, and as the yawning musician looked up with pencil poised, hum something that seemed to jog along somehow in step with the words there on the paper in his hand. Woolcott undersells the something that Berlin hummed. The melody, Furia writes, was surprisingly intricate with shifting meters and tonalities. Following the usual practice of Tin Pan Alley composers of immigrant songs, Berlin casts his verse, introduction, in a minor ethnic mode, and his chorus in a more modern and American major key. But at the point in the chorus where the barber cries, "Please, Anunga, stop!" the music shifts back to the minor key to underscore the loss of the Italian runner. Berlin, in other words, had in an unguarded moment, and under pressure, revealed, probably to his own surprise, what was to be the engine of his genius, a gift for inventing melodies that were at once appropriate to the lyrics and something more, memorable. Watterson's $25 offer was doubly significant. It was karmically equivalent to the sum that had gotten Izzy fired from the Pelham, and big enough money that the neophyte couldn't pass it up. But in reality, it was a sucker's deal, the kind that music publishers frequently made with hungry composers. The writer, or writers, got some flash cash. The song and all subsequent profits therefrom belonged to the purchaser, and profits could be substantial. Waterson, a horse player by avocation, had made a winning bet on Durando, which wound up making a decent-sized splash in vaudeville and earning the huge sum of $20,000, not for Berlin, but for the firm of Waterson and Snyder. Yet the song earned something far bigger for Izzy. The name that appeared alone on the cover of Durando's sheet music, let the boys in the back room at Nigger Mike's or Jimmy Kelly's say what they would, was the name he felt entitled to take on at last, Irving Berlin. Right out of the gate, Berlin, barely 21, had demonstrated a prodigious ability to write witty, affecting commercial lyrics, words that compelled and intrigued and lingered in the mind. With amazing suddenness, he was able to speak in his own uniquely charming voice on the page. His public awaited, and Berlin kicked into gear. 3 weeks after Durando, he and a composer named Edgar Leslie published a comic song based on a serious topic. The scandal stirred up in New York the previous fall by Richard Strauss's opera, Salome, with its severed head of John the Baptist, and the title character's Dance of the Seven Veils. Instead of the stepdaughter of Herod, Berlin and Leslie's Sadie Salome, Go Home, gives us Sadie Cohen, a young singer who left her happy home to become an actress lady. And not just any actress lady, mind you, but a striptease artiste reenacting Salome's infamous dance. The rollicking chorus is in the voice of her sweetheart, Mose. "Don't do that dance, I tell you, Sadie. That's not a business for a lady. Most everybody knows that I'm your loving Mose. Oi, 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 oi! Where is your clothes?" This is truly a breakthrough song, light years from Marie from sunny Italy, miles even past Durando. Berlin could write effectively enough in the Italian dialect he remembered from the Lower East Side, but the Yiddish idiom was in his bones. He would put ethnic songs aside as the fad waned in the 19-teens, its demise hastened by World War I's attendant xenophobia. For now, though, there was real gold to be mined from it, and all at once, employment. On the strength of the sheet music sales of Sadie Salome, some 250,000 copies, Waterson and Snyder offered Berlin a job as a staff lyricist at $25 a week, plus royalties on any of his songs that the firm published. He could quit Jimmy Kelly's and put his waiter's apron aside forever. He finally had his $25 a week, his idea of heaven. Irving Berlin's heaven, however, turned out to be a place of unrelenting hard work. The success of Sadie Salome, combined with the confidence of a paycheck, liberated Berlin. A universe of possibilities opened up. At the barber shop one afternoon, he encountered a singer and occasional songwriter he was friendly with, one George Whiting. When Berlin asked Whiting if he was free to go to the theater that night, Whiting said that since his wife had gone to the country, he was on his own. Berlin, as he later recalled to a journalist, replied, "Gee, that's a good title for a song." And we went back to the office, wrote it, and sang it that night at a cafe before an audience of 30 people. And it went, so much so that the orders were pouring in the next day, while in 4 days, it was about the best-known song in America. Even allowing for exaggeration, it's an amazing story. And it wasn't much of an exaggeration. The main hyperbole is the brevity of the phrase, "wrote it." The two men slaved for hours, struggling to transcend the obvious and achieve the memorable, to fulfill, in short, the promise of the title line. Berlin again. "All night I sweated to find what I knew was there, and finally I speared the lone word, just a single word that made the song, and a fortune." The single word was hurrah, spelled thus in the title but pronounced hooray. "That lone word," Berlin said, "gave the whole idea of the song in one quick wallop. It gave the singer a chance to hoot with sheer joy. It invited the roomful to join in the hilarious shout." It was probably well past midnight on a late spring evening when Berlin and Whiting repaired in triumph to Maxime's, next door to the Waterson and Snyder offices on 38th Street. The crowd had thinned in the wee hours. The Nighthawks remaining were hard-bitten show business types. Yet the effect of the song on the men was electric. "My wife's gone to the country. Hooray! Hooray! She thought it best. I need a rest. That's why she went away. She took the children with her. Hooray! Hooray! I love my wife, but oh, you kid, my wife's gone away." With its racy implication of imminent debauches, the song went, as Berlin said. The sheet music sold 300,000 copies, and Berlin, under the terms of his new royalty deal with Waterson and Snyder, made a penny a copy, $3,000, the equivalent of more than $70,000 today. The just-turned 21-year-old, who only a few months before had been singing for tossed nickels and dimes at Jimmy Kelly's, suddenly had more money than he knew what to do with. Or rather, amazingly enough for a 21-year-old, Irving Berlin knew exactly what to do with it. For one thing, he kept writing as though the devil himself were prodding him with his pitchfork. And he kept thinking more and more about writing music as well as words. He had taught himself to play the piano, after a fashion, back at the Pelham Cafe, where he'd tinkered in his off hours with Nick Nicholson's upright. At first, and then ever afterward, only in the key of F sharp, the nigger keys, in the coarse vernacular of the era, so called because F sharp contained 5 black keys and only 2 white, and so used by many beginning pianists because, as Berlin later explained, the black keys are right there under your fingers. At the Pelham, he had also listened with astonishment to the visiting Harlem stride pianist Lucky Roberts, a tiny fellow with enormous hands. He could span a 14th, and prodigious rhythmic verve. Though Izzy could only gape at Roberts' also self-taught virtuosity, he was inspired rather than intimidated. The rhythm of ragtime was sexual and intoxicating, and he felt it with the same high-wire certainty that guided all his early compositional efforts. "I know rhythm," he would solemnly inform a magazine writer in 1915, at the ripe old age of 26. More and more, he also knew music. With his earnings, Berlin bought a second-hand upright piano, but not just any upright. His new instrument was a 6-octave Wesser Brothers transposing piano, with a control wheel mounted under the right side of the keyboard that allowed a melody played in one key to sound in another. Berlin could thus keep right on playing in F sharp, but the music would come out in C, D, B flat, or any other key, depending on the turn of the wheel. In honor of that steering wheel-like appendage, which in later models became a simple lever, he called the new instrument his Buick. His new employers were nervous. They had hired him to write lyrics, and they wanted him to stick to his knitting. Ted Snyder's disquiet certainly had to do with competitiveness. 7 years older than Berlin, all full of tunes and knowing roughly 20 times as much about music as Berlin did, in Woolcott's words, Snyder was a lanky Midwesterner, a Ray Bolger type, physically, all bones and Adam's apple and toothy smiles. In 1909, though still in his late 20s, he was not only a successful music publisher, but an estimable songwriter. He would go on to have a reasonably distinguished career. His 2 most famous compositions were 1921's The Sheik of Araby, and as co-writer, 1923's Who's Sorry Now? On the other hand, his ear was good enough that he may well have realized that this musically illiterate kid, this cheeky gutter snipe, had the potential to leave him in the dust. Throughout the latter half of 1909, Berlin bided his time, dutifully penning the words to a string of Snyder tunes, such deathless compositions as Do Your Duty, Doctor, Oh, 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 Doctor, Wild Cherries, Coony Spoony Rag, and Some Little Something About You. In the meantime, he was listening, playing, planning. The lyrics he wrote for his boss were strictly workaday, almost as though Izzy was holding something back for himself. out it popped at the end of November, with the third song for which he and he alone had composed both words and music. Yiddle on your fiddle, play some ragtime. Like Durando, Yiddle had an unrestrained quality, an air of liberation. The verse begins in a solemn minor mode. In fact, it's a direct musical quote of the Hebrew hymn, Hatikva. Everyone was singing, dancing, springing at a wedding yesterday. Yiddle on his fiddle played some ragtime, and when Sadie heard him play... That fourth line, though, shifts into major, signaling the upcoming effervescence of the chorus. It's Sadie who's talking. Yiddle in the middle of your fiddle, play some ragtime. Get busy, I'm dizzy, I'm feeling 2 years young. In fact, it was Irving Berlin who was getting busy. The following month, he came out with another solo composition, also ragtimey, also with a musical quote, that mesmerizing Mendelssohn tune. The title's irreverent bounce is just the beginning of the tune's originality. The melody of the verse had an elegant lilt that any seasoned songwriter would envy. The first phrase of the chorus, "Love me to that ever-lovin' spring song melody," was set to that self-same Mendelssohn air. But then, as the syncopation kicked in, the love got a little lustier. "Please me, honey, squeeze me to that Mendelssohn strain. Kiss me like you would your mother. One good kiss deserves another." Who had the gall to taint the sacred name and music of a classical composer with ragtime and sex? And who, by the way, put a word like mesmerizing in a song title? Who even knew what it meant? Berlin. That was who. Though he was barely old enough to vote, he was already learning to make his own rules, and the public was buying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.